Hey guys, Dylan from the Geek Duo here, and today I'll be bringing you my reaction to Doctor Who 60th Anniversary Special 2, titled Wild Blue Yonder. The TARDIS takes the Doctor and Donna to the furthest edge of adventure. To escape, they must face the most desperate fight of their lives, with the fate of the universe at stake. So, got absolutely no idea what to expect from this one, because there was very little of it in the trailers. Like, most of it was the Star Beast. There was little scenes from The Giggle and brief snippets of this one. So, got absolutely no idea what to expect. Other than, we get more Doctor and Donna, so that's always going to be enjoyable. So, I guess, with... that just means can't really speculate, so let's get this started in 3, 2, 1, go. England, 1666. Is that meant to be Isaac Newton? Yes. Hello. God damn it, Donna. Gravity. Dumbass. Probably the only time I'm gonna call Sir Isaac Newton a dumbass, but... what I want is from now on, for any time gravity is mentioned in the show, for it to be called Mavity. Just for continuity's sake. Oops. What was with the music? I think it's angry. like a lot of songs. It seems to be a prison. Is everybody? You'd think there'd be at least a couple people wandering around a long hallway like this. Never say that, Donna. Well, I did say I wanted it, but you mean the Sonic that was in the door? Or something. Yeah. And I have a feeling it's not the thing that's in the walls. They're making us think it's the thing in the walls, so it's probably not. to you. A little old. It is weird. It's going to be making sudden moves eventually, isn't it? How long till I run into the same robot? Okay, not a loop. These look like stasis things. Did it let something out, or did it let something in? Is it a spaceship or? Because there's no like stars or anything. know, stars may mean end of time. The universe also works. Nothing. It might have been someone, well, something coming in, or it might have been the people of the ship being like, we've got nothing else to do, we're stuck here, might as well go out on our own terms. Venslaw, Collis, and he takes another step. Basically a server room, I guess. Dang it, Doctor. That may be an issue. Okay, so there's two doctors and two donors. That is a wee bit long. Okay, yes, it was something coming into the ship. Well, that is disturbing. Yeah, they got too big. Who says they hate you? Find you. I'll always find you. I wasn't paying enough attention to what the word that it said then. Right, okay. So I'm guessing the coldness is the sign that they're close. Or that there may be more of them. How would I know that? Probably I don't know which one. You know the Timeless Child story. But Donna doesn't know that. I'm pretty sure that was the yeah, that was the Jody story. Got him distracted. What is the purpose of these no things? They just seem to be taunting them. Here's the thing, out of all of the doctors, I know 14 is different from 10, despite having similar mannerisms, it's still very different from 10. Yet this face is the one who was the darkest, in my opinion, from what I've seen, and the most likely to have to deal with things. Really? It's questions. Well, now they have the answer. slow countdown. Speed up the countdown. Really? That's cheating. Really? What is the doctor's plan? like to have someone to talk about with. I did hear he'd film some things for this. Save us? Well, that was a very strange episode. I will give it that. Very, very strange. I was wrong about a lot of assumptions in this. Mainly that it wasn't the things in the walls that were the issue. I really thought that things hiding in the walls were going to be the original inhabitants of the spaceship. And that the friendly crew that we find out is going to actually be what the issue was. No, it was a very crazy metaphysical entity that does, if you think about it too much, the concept of nothing beyond the edge of everything, and for that nothing to actually be something, is really hurts the brain. So, but I guess that's always been the point of Doctor Who, to visit concepts and things. Started out as a fun way to teach science and history, and now it's getting into the metaphysical as our understanding of science gets more into what is the unknown. So it makes it. I did. So there was reports that were put out saying that the Phlox storyline would be continued now that Russell T. Davies is back, because that was, there were a lot of people I heard were upset because that just seemingly went nowhere once it was sorted out. That whole antimatter wave or whatever it was, just consuming parts of the galaxy. And I had heard that it would come back. So the fact that they mentioned it to this doctor, the bridge doctor between the one who first encountered it, the one who blames herself for it, or for, she blames herself for not saving the things that were taken by it, and the one who may have to deal with the repercussions of all that, is very interesting. They also, they mentioned the Timeless Child, which has that actually been mentioned in the show since it was revealed? Like, I know the Doctor came through some rift in space to Gallifrey before the Time Lords had their cycle of regeneration, because they got their cycle of regeneration from studying whatever the Doctor is, synthesizing that and bringing it into their gene pool. So they could replicate it, but they had the limit of 12. And they put a limiter on the Doctor themselves once they had everything sorted out. At least that's the way it was described to me. I'm not sure if I have that 100% correct, because as I said, I haven't seen Jodie's actual stories, but has it actually been brought up in the show, other than this special, between that episode and now? Because if it hasn't, and the new showrunner is bringing attention to it in the same episode that they brought attention to the flux in that, with the Doctor that they're going to be continuing on from, makes it seem like we're going to be getting more information about what the Doctor actually is as well in the coming seasons. Also, what the hell is the Celestial Toymaker doing? How are they manipulating people to go crazy with anger in that? Plus, well, I was going to say something wild and be like, what if they're marketing him as the Celestial Toymaker, but he's actually, yet again, the Master? Because after the Rasputin thing, did that Master die, or is he still out there? Because if this is the next one, I doubt it, but this could well be the next form of the Master, because you remember Ten's Master was the one who managed to take over the world and all that. So for the next one, in the same time that they encounter Ten, to also be doing something to affect all of the people, turn them crazy and everything, it would make sense. Plus give another reason as to why this face came back, because we still don't know why the Doctor came back as the same face, so I really thought by now we'd have at least some, like, breadcrumbs that we could follow as to why. I mean, is it as simple as just the Doctor needed this face to be able to interact with these specific people, because these specific people were the ones that were the next in danger? That is the one thing I've never really understood about Doctor Who, because the Doctor is always there to save the people from a coming cataclysm. However, they've also experienced time well beyond that cataclysm. So is this a circular loop thing where they were always the one to stop it? Or is their actions causing branches to create new timeline in which this cataclysm happens, and the times that they've been ahead of it are actually different? That's the thing I've never understood with this. It's never really been explained in what I've seen as to how the Doctor is needed to solve these major events, these major species-ending events, when they've seen that it always ends out this for them to have survived, so. But yeah, those no things were very... you can't even really call them evil, because as they said, they fed off of everything that drifted out to them from the known universe, and the bad events travel further than the good. So you'd need to be on the edge of the universe for your good events to reach them, whereas the bad events were much further in, compounded with all of the ones between the edge and then would reach them easier. So it's understandable how they can be shaped by darkness so much easier than light. I did pick out the fact that the captain killed herself. That was one of the ones I threw out there. To begin with, I did think it was the no things coming in as well, but very weird. I wonder if concepts like them will come back, or if this is a one-time thing. Because if they mention that they wanted to come to the main universe, what is to stop them in the event that some ship manages to slip through the same wormhole without a captain like the one that ship had? And then they would be able to acclimate themselves, and because it's highly unreasonable to think that there are only two no things out there. Heck, we don't even really know if there were two. That could have been a singular entity taking the form of two, or it could well have been multiple taking the form of one each. Because they mentioned that they had tried to copy the captain. Was that both of them attempting to copy the captain? Was that a singular form attempting to copy the captain? Who knows? Plus, how did the captain figure out that it needed to be a slow mind, a Zen calm mind, to be able to get them to not read it? Because I don't think I'd have been able to reach that assumption. At least not in the time frame that they were on the ship, so. How did the captain manage it? Anyway, like I said, very weird episode. Very heavy topics to think about if you actually let yourself sit there and think about them for too long, so it's best not to do that. And with that being said, I'll catch you in the next one.